Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Activities for People Living at Home with Dementia. We are proud to offer this series with funding from the Area Agency on Aging and the United Way of Tarrant County. These programs are recorded and are made available for viewing through a YouTube channel for future use. I am Martha Brown, your host for today. Our topic today is brought to you by Peggy Spear with the Amon Carter Museum of American Art. She's going to give us info about hunting and fishing.
Oh, goody.
Goody, goody.
Peggy, take it away.
Hunting and fishing.
You're going to bring back memories.
We've actually done this topic in the past. Ooh. And as you can imagine, in an American art museum, we've got plenty of hunting and fishing scenes to go over. So these should be, hopefully, I'm trying to make it so I can see all your sweet shining faces. All right, there we go.
We can do 2 hours if you want. We can do 2 hours if you can.
I'm game.
Then it's really going to be me making things up. I'm like, and so I picked 4 artworks that some are iconic, some are lesser known, but let's just get into it. This is a fan favorite. This is currently hanging on view in our, this is a really terrible reproduction, hanging on view in our galleries right now. Massive. It's 40 inches by 60 inches. So it anchors that wall that it's hanging on. But it's entitled The Hunter's Return. So
see that.
A dead giveaway, but what do we see here?
Well, there are 2 people carrying probably a deer or a moose or whatever.
You're right. You cannot tell in this reproduction, which I don't know why it's so bad, but yes, they have a deer across the stick hanging by its hooves. Mm-hmm. So that's the hunting part. We've identified the hunting part. What else do we see happening?
There are children.
They're children. Looks like they've got a garden.
Yep.
Yeah. Beautiful fall scene.
Fall scenery.
Fall.
Exactly. Yeah. It is.
And yet, what makes you say that it's fall? It's pretty obvious.
Or just the colors you can see the trees and the mountain in the background, you know.
Yeah, it's fall. It's from what I can tell, it's not any specific place. It's just meant to be an American landscape. Cole was working in the New England area, so it might be pretty reflective of some of the land he's seeing there. And the fall in New England is some of the best. Mm-hmm. So those leaves he's picking up, he's depicting the different colors. Very.
Most of us don't go that far to New England.
Well, I'm gonna tell you, Paula, you got to get up there for some leaf peeping, because you are missing out, sister.
Yeah. We have been in that area, but we don't go frequently.
Yeah.
Because it's far away.
There's Colorado, which is closer, so you're kind of spoiled when. If you're going to go see some leaves, then Colorado ain't a bad place to go see it.
Yeah, North Carolina is a great one, too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anything on the Appalachian.
Yeah, the western part of North Carolina is just gorgeous.
Yeah. Especially, it's looking more gorgeous when it was 100 degrees on Monday.
Ooh.
So.
And it was 62 degrees this morning.
Oh, yeah, beautiful. It was beautiful.
Dude, that is way too cold.
What?
No, we
don't like it.
It's just the right amount of cold.
No, it is. I disagree.
I don't think it was 32.
No, 52.
62,
Philip, not 62.
62. 62.
It's 74 right now.
Yeah.
It's 74 now? Oh, my word.
I was reading the captioning.
Okay, so yeah, so we're living vicariously then. For those who want a cooler fall morning, we've got that happening right here.
I know you said this is not a specific place, but it looks suspiciously like Half Dome with a wrinkle.
Oh.
That would be Yosemite, though, wouldn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
But you did say this is not a particular.
I don't think so. Not from what I could find. It's meant to sort of be the kind of the Eden of American landscape. Yeah. You've got the lake.
Yep. You've
got the mountain. And I had a professor in graduate school, who a Western art professor, and he spoke so eloquently of mountains in paintings. And it always kind of stuck with me. During this era of painting the landscape and the Western frontier and things like that, particularly this mindset of manifest destiny, you'll see a lot of mountains and they sort of look like they're curling forward.
Mm-hmm.
And he said it was the land bowing or the land bowing to man, and this idea of the land was turning itself over to the idea of manifest
going on. Yes, I'm if I'm missing, I go back.
Say that again, Don.
Hey, I noticed that there's a lot of tree stumps cut down trees.
Yeah.
I wonder if that wood wasn't used to build the cabin.
I bet so.
It had to have been, and that insinuation that we needed the trees to build their home or their homestead. But you picked on something that was Cole's reoccurring theme throughout many of his landscapes. We see this beautiful landscape, this idea of the land, you know, there for the taking, but it comes at a price. This beautiful land is being destroyed by humans.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so he would include these cut down trees and these tree stumps as a reminder of, yes, it's beautiful, but we're destroying it. We as humans are destroying it. Sometimes he was a little more heavy handed than others. The people who were paying him to make these artworks were the people who were cutting down the trees. So he couldn't bite the hand that fed him too much. But there was this underlying current of the ravage of the axe. The decimation of the land.
Hmm.
He spoke to it, and we see, you know, the success of the hunt. As Yetta pointed out, they've got, it's a buck. When you see it in real life, you can see it's got horns. There's the, you know, a large family. There's a little girl in the door. There's a little girl running here, hugging a dog. Their mom's holding a baby. They've got a bountiful garden. A beautiful home. They're on a lake so they can fish if they need to. You know, this is this idea of human and nature living in perfect harmony. But he's keeping us humble and reminding us it's not perfect harmony down at the bottom.
I'm surprised that they were thinking about that in 1845.
That's why I was going to say, did the people that looked at this actually understand what he was saying here?
Yes and no. A lot of people were, this was the time of manifest destiny, and it was justified and expected. So I'm sure that, you know, the lumber magnates and the oil, you know, all of, or not oil at this point, but railroad, that whole industry felt like, oh yes, this is a scene we're familiar with, but we are in charge of the land. And so, yes, we have to destroy if we want to prosper. So I don't think certain audiences probably recognize, yeah, this is what we're doing, but we have to. And then more of the environmentalists, which there were of this time, many transcendentalists and environmentalists were thinking about the larger implications of destroying the land. But he makes it look so beautiful. I mean, he is.
Yes, he does.
This is in our landscape gallery, because it really is just as much about the land as it is about the success of the family.
Mm-hmm.
Good choice.
So, say that again, Martha.
Good choice.
Yeah, this one is a favorite. This is a really, it's such a beautiful artwork in person. And that light, Cole was a master at creating that dusky or dawn type of light.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Really, really very beautiful artwork. All right, so we're leaving this, we're seeing this domestic scene at the bottom, and now we're really gonna focus on this domestic scene.
Oh my goodness.
Say that again?
Oh my goodness.
Yeah,
It's just like you've turned your camera.
It's a very common theme in American art history during this time of, you know, 40s, 50s, 60s of manifest destiny. But Palmer has a very different lens that she's focusing on. So she is focused, what is she focusing on?
The hunters coming back?
Yeah, the bounty. She's focused on the bounty.
Yes, mm-hmm. The bounty.
I have a car.
Hot whip.
Yeah, Hot Wheels.
Yeah, they're focusing on the bounty.
Peggy, what town, what area are we looking at here?
Minnesota? You know what I call it? What we don't know. And this was specifically done as a way to tell Americans, this isn't any, it just is a Western frontier. So it could be Montana, it could be Colorado, it could be Oklahoma. It was just meant to interest, because this was printed in a way that was distributed to Americans everywhere, particularly Americans on the East Coast. So this idea of the West meant a lot of people had only a vision of the West. So this is kind of that vision of the West, even though it's no place particular. This was the story the East Coasters loved to hear or to read or to see.
1867, my word.
Yeah. So this is, she's really focusing on the bounty of the West. Again, she's truly focusing on the positive of manifest destiny.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. I mean, look, you've got more birds than you can shake a stick at, a multi-point buck. So big old buck, look at all that wheat that they've been able to harvest. Yep. Mm-hmm. They've got a fully functioning barn with the chickens and the goats, multiple kids, a beautiful homestead. I mean, this is what the American West was.
And they even had a haystack.
Is that what that is?
I think
haystack and firewood.
Yep. And firewood. Mm-hmm. Wait, firewood right here. Yeah. I mean, there's the tree stump, but we kind of what you all hit on earlier. It's the tree stump, you're assuming it's just for the wood. It's not making a commentary on the destruction of the world. It was we are being resourceful and we're using what we have to have a successful homestead. And so it's the same, you know, I'm going to cut back real fast. It's the same, again, terrible reproduction scene we're seeing here, but really focusing on the domestic bliss, the harmony within nature, not what the ramifications are of this harmony.
Mm-hmm. Steve, do I see a dog?
You do see a couple. Yeah.
I think so.
Two dogs.
Two
of
them. Oh,
on
yeah.
I'm looking at... a lump of something right next to the house in between the windows.
It might be rocks or something. It's nothing of significance.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
I think the field of stacked grain is significant.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, successful harvest, living off our land. I mean, it's all the positives of the American West, which the New Yorkers, East Coasters would love. This particular artist, it's likely she never left west of the Mississippi. So this is, again, a complete fabrication of what the West looked like.
So do you know what I'm surprised about, Peggy?
Please tell me.
The two men, it's as if it's neighbors or so that they go hunting, and do they then share the hunt?
They might be brothers.
Yeah, it's unclear what their relationship is. It because he feels a little too old to be a son based on the ages of the other children.
Yes. And there's only one mother.
Yeah, and he has that poor woman. And he has facial hair, which in this artwork, which again, terrible, you can maybe see he doesn't have facial hair, but the dad does. So it's assumed that they're all part of a family unit, and that's just an older, younger child.
Mm-hmm. The cabin's not finished yet.
Here, we don't know. We're not seeing another homestead. So it could be a neighbor. It could be someone who's living with them, but it doesn't feel you're picking up on it right. It's not a child. It's not someone that's an immediate in the
brothers or neighbors. Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that that woman standing in the doorway saying, "Oh, great, more birds for me to have to pluck."
Yep.
Yeah, these don't look field dressed in any
no,
way.
No. Hey, yeah. Hey, baby, mm-hmm. Could you go back to the last of the picture, please?
Yeah.
I just noticed something on that picture where the cabin had a nice roof on it. This mm-hmm. is a cabin that they have here. The roof's not complete on it.
It's a thatch.
This one right here?
Yeah.
It's a thatched roof.
You think it's thatch roof? Okay.
Yeah.
Guys, I can't even tell you. I can't remember that detail, but I just feel like this reproduction is not showing you. It's a pretty done home because there's ivy growing on it. So it doesn't feel like they're just still settling in. It feels very settled.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you, Steve.
I'm sorry. I don't remember that detail. I'm looking at it up close. Yeah, so this was a very popular scene of these hunting, bounty, everything is right in the West scenes, which the public was very used to seeing at the time. And nothing graphic about the home.
Thinking about the luck.
Say that again,
Phil. About the roofs. The roof on this house here looks like it's sawn lumber.
It does, yeah.
You know? So you're
right.
Again, that there's no sawmills around, you know.
Yeah, they have all that.
It's like a little bit of her New York is showing when she's doing details that would not match what is happening out West.
The style reminds me of Courier and Ives.
Yes.
It does. It is Courier. This is a Courier and Ives print.
Okay.
And so it's about 18 by 26. So again, it was available for purchase. Families could decorate their home rather cheaply with these prints. And this particular artist, is estimated she did over 200 lithographs during her time at Courier and Ives.
Wow.
She was really involved in the printing part of it as well, which Courier and Ives had the artists and then they had the printers, but she was just as involved in the printing and actually helped improve the printing technology at Courier and Ives. So for a female artist, she was killing the game during her day and was a household name. People knew who she was.
Okay.
All right, so now we're leaving our hunting scenes. We're going to hit some fishing scenes.
All right, ice fishing. Yay.
Ice fishing, yeah.
Winter,
yeah. So if the fall were too cold in the last couple paintings ago, now we're really getting cold.
Yeah, really.
So you see ice fishing. What are some of the details you're noticing within the scene?
Fish.
Yeah, again, a bountiful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you got a basket sitting on some evergreen leaf pine mm-hmm. Branches or something.
Yeah.
I used to put the fish in, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And a friend sitting on a log.
Yeah.
It looks like a friend has a hole in front of him also.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Dropped in.
And they're fairly close to shore.
Yeah.
Yes. Why do you say that, Yetta?
Because, when I think, I have never seen it or done it, but when you think about ice fishing, you think of big lakes and they drive their cars out in the middle of the lake.
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, we don't have our SUVs driving us out right now in these days, but you're right. So they're pretty close to shore. You can tell that the trees, too, wouldn't be out super far. They'd mm-hmm. be probably right on shoreline. You can see mm-hmm. here almost a bank behind the sitting fishermen. It feels windy. Do you get that sense? You almost feel mm-hmm. the cold looking at this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can see his coat blowing, that top layer of snow off the ice is picking up. And the popped collar. Whenever you see a popped collar in a winter scene, ooh boy, you know it's cold.
Yeah. Yeah.
When you see a what?
A popped collar, his collar's up really high.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You can see this man here, his collar.
I've never heard that pop collar.
Pop collar, yeah, I never heard that.
No. I hadn't either, so we both learned something today, Yetta.
Yeah,
really. I just keep thinking about that poor guy with earmuffs, no mitts.
Maybe it's to kill this.
Cold ears and
bear is coming or something.
Yeah. This man back here looks like he's a little wiser. He's got some mittens on his hand.
Yeah.
Look, on the ground, oof. Cold.
But
But this is the spike in the ice is basically what they use to make holes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's what it's for. That stick there. Okay.
Yeah, it's got a spear end on a probably a metal end mm-hmm. on it that they chip the ice out.
Okay.
So this they're hunting. They're fishing for trout. They're in a lake. This particular lake is, I don't even know how to Chattahoochee. I don't think I'm saying it right. It's in the Adirondacks in upstate New York.
Chattahoochee.
Pre-Civil War, this destination, this lake was a big destination for avid outdoorsmen, sportsmen, anglers, fishers, hunters. This was the place to go. You left New York City or Maine or Boston, wherever, and this was a very popular place to go. There were camps and cabins there for that activity. Tate, the artist, was a massive outdoorsman. So he did a lot of hunting and fishing in his career. So this is something he was very familiar with. He knew technique and he knew tools, and he would go fishing at this particular lake himself. After the Civil War, which this is pre-Civil War, but after the Civil War, this turned to this area became a resort and destination vacation spot for the businessmen in the city. So this is the camping and outdoorsman lifestyle was still very much how that land was used.
So we could have been hearing people in New York City saying, I want to go out for the summer.
Yeah,
this would have been the location.
One of, yeah, there, you know, all along the Adirondacks was very popular. This is the northern Adirondacks.
Oh.
And like, I don't know if any of you watch The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, but that show. Yeah. So they go to upstate New York for their family vacation. That was when that started, those camps and those destinations and locations started becoming popular.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. And so Tate was a tried and true huntsman and angler. So this might have actually been one of his fishing spots that he's capturing here. And we've got one more. So we're seeing, you know, the relaxing and of the relaxing side of hunting or the fun, the sport. And here we're really seeing the relaxing.
Wow.
Oh, on the riverbanks. Yeah.
Cane pole.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
anybody
this
ever
is,
anybody ever have a cane pole?
I have. I used them several times. A lot of them.
The first pole I ever had was a cane pole.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, this is, this particular artist is capturing a lazy Sunday on the Sacramento River, right in Sacramento area. This is where he was working and what he's photographing. He was, he basically has no notoriety within this group called Group F64. It was a group of 11 photographers, some of them, you know, like Ansel Adams or Edward Weston or Imogen Cunningham. Those are like the big names within this group of 11. We were on the West Coast, and they were breaking from the photography norm at the time, which was pictorialism, which you might remember the name Edward Stieglitz or Paul Strand. We've looked at photographs of them in the past. They were in this movement of pictorialism. So this actually looks like a pictorialist picture, where things were kind of hazy and mm-hmm. almost dreamlike and very beautiful. And their goal was to make, for pictorialists, to make the picture look like a painting, add that fine art element to it, to make it have the same footing as painting. So they really were very artistic in putting their hand back in with the blurring and the development process. Well, these guys over on the West Coast were like, that's not for us. Pictures are used for documenting, and that's what we're going to do. So F64 is a setting on your aperture that allows for the most depth within a photograph, so that it's very crisp. it's very clear. It's a long exposure time or short exposure time. So it allows a very sharp and quick capture of what the scene is. And so they were focused on capturing, documenting in a way, but they were still using it as a fine art because they would use their viewfinder to frame the picture in that moment. Bye, Steve.
Bye, we'll see you folks tomorrow.
All right, bye, Steve. Bye. See you, Steve.
Bye. Oh no, I'll see you on Friday.
Friday, okay.
Friday, yeah.
So it was basically the opposite of what was going on that East Coast. They were really focused, like Ansel Adams, if you can think of Ansel Adams photographs, they're very crisp, dark black and white. There's not much loviness to it, storiness to it, that other artists on the East Coast were doing at the time. This kind of has that pictorialist feel because it's a little blurry, it's a little glowy. I think it's because it's just so bright out in the morning that might have interfered with the capture with the aperture. But he's framing the picture. And how can you tell he's framing the picture? What elements are you seeing?
You see that they're standing on a bend in the river, which is probably a good place to fish.
Yeah, he's using that bend as a way to kind of keep your attention. You know, you might start down here, you're up, and then you look over here. You're following that bend. Your eye is staying within that photograph just because he placed the camera in a certain position.
And something's going on at the top. Is that swimmers?
Mm-hmm. You know, it looks like it's actually like posts or poles that are in the water.
Yeah.
Oh.
But there's that mimicking of, you know, two
swimmers
standing vertically, mimicking the poles, the people standing vertically, which then is mimicked here by the trees. So there's that, while you're going up, you're following the curve while you're following the vertical lines.
See any of the fishing.
My father used to get me up early in the morning when we would go out camping and get me up before dawn to drag me down to a body of water and fish. I hated it.
Do you still hate fishing now because of that? Or
yes.
Why did he want to go so early?
Because when the fish are biting.
Exactly.
They bite in the breakfast.
Yeah. I had an uncle that would take me, he fished for, what do you call them, carp in the lake in central Illinois. And he'd take me out, you know, late in the night. And because that was the best time that he could just throw the hook out with some stinky bait on it and the carp would take it. So he took those fish and he buried them around my grandmother's rose bushes for fertilizer.
Oh, really? Oh, my word.
Never heard of that.
And she had a really nice rose garden.
We can thank the carp for that, huh?
Yes.
Oh, Don, thank you for that info.
Yeah, that's cool.
There's not much else you can use a carp for. I mean, it's not really good eating.
No,
I thought they would be good. No?
Very good food.
No.
I don't even know.
Does anyone still fish or, you know, just throw a line whenever they can?
No.
Yeah.
Nope.
You know, Don, talking about.
Say that again.
Talking about your carp, it's cultural differences. In America, carp is kind of considered a trash fish, something that you'd want to bury under the roses.
Yes.
And in Japan, they're considered a delicacy.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. I've never tasted carp, so I can't judge.
Yeah, Phil, have you ever had carp? Does it taste good?
I have not. I've not even eaten it because they buried them.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Did you ask Phil that question or Don?
Yeah, anybody. Has anybody eaten Phil? Have you? Phil, have you? Or is anybody else?
I ate it in Japan, yes.
Yes.
How did they cook it?
I liked it just fine. A lot of Japanese cookie. At least they cooked the carp. I didn't have
to cook it raw. That's right.
Yeah. All right, friends. Well, those are our hunting and fishing tales for this week. Next week, we are back with butterflies. We actually have some butterflies on view right now in our gallery. So we'll look at those and others in our collection.
All right.
Excellent.
Before you go, Peggy, yesterday we had Fort Worth Museum of Science and History. And Lee Naylor said to tell you hello.
She used to work here. How sweet. I haven't seen her in a while.
And she thought you would smile.
Thank you for sharing. If you guys see her next week, tell her I said hello back.
And we'll see her in November, and I will.
Oh, good.
She's here first.
She's right down the street. I mean, they've been closed now for they were closed for about a year, and they reopened again in June. So people we used to see just through foot traffic or popping in and saying hi, that all kind of stopped. So I haven't heard her name in a while, so I'm happy.
Sweet. Well, we're glad to share it with you.
Thank you. All right, y'all be good. Peggy. I'll see you next week, okay?
All right.
Bye, Peggy.
Bye, Peggy.
Bye. 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 Bye.